the organizers for the opportunity to talk about our work here. And so the previous talk has been a lot about how we can use ontologies to compute different things on. My talk is more how do we actually construct ontologies. And I'm going to argue for a new way of constructing ontologies coming directly from data, in particular from large-scale molecular network data. I'll just go ahead and start. So during the last 10 years or so, biology has really made this leap, this large shift from what has been really a single gene biology to module biology, where we can study the how genes and proteins interact with each other and form complexes and pathways, and how these pathways function in different biological processes and also in disease. But we all know that just as the cell is not a bag of genes, it's also not a bag of disconnected cellular components. So I think we'd all know that the cell rather resembles a hierarchy where genes connect to form complexes and pathways, and these pathways themselves connect to form larger biological processes which give rise to the living cell. And so the challenge now is how do we actually model these hierarchies? How do we come up with the hierarchical models from data, and how to use these hierarchical models to compute on? And so really this is the challenge that we're facing. And so let's look at some of the hierarchical models that are around there in biology. And perhaps one of the best known hierarchical models today is the gene ontology, which we're all aware of and we know very well from previous talk also. So in the gene ontology, it's a DAG-structured hierarchy in which the nodes represent cellular components, biological processes, or molecular functions, and edges represent relationships between terms, such as part of or is a or regulates relationships, depending on which ontology and then which type of relationship we're looking at. And you know, the big thing about the gene ontology is that by many it's considered a gold standard. It's used throughout in many different genomics analysis. It's hard to find a paper without the use of the gene ontology or an analogous resource. And it really has become a gold standard. And so the way it is a gold standard is really because it's manually curated. So people go in, they read papers, biological experts, go in, read papers, and annotate the gene ontology with new terms and relationships. And so that really makes it a gold standard. But at the same time, it's really impossible for the structure to discover anything new. So we're stuck with this model that's very static in a way. So you know, people have to go and write papers about a new component, and some other people have to read these papers, and they have to put in those components into this model, and then others can use this. And so the question we ask is, given these large-scale molecular networks, given the amount of data that we have today, can we take these networks and large data sets and can we try to structure an ontology directly from data as opposed to going in and writing papers and then curating the papers and so on? And so really this is the question that we were facing in the start. And so to begin answering this question, we first looked at the gene ontology itself. And we looked at different types of molecular interaction networks. And we're looking at yeast, for starters, because it's probably the organism that has the best annotated data sets and the best networks, the most complete network data of all the organisms today. And so we looked at all types of different networks for yeast, physical protein-protein interaction networks, genetic interaction networks, co-expression measurements, and so on. And we tried to see how do they actually correspond to the gene ontology, and can we find evidence, can we find support for the gene ontology in the network data itself? And so we did something very simple. We just basically took the gene ontology terms from small terms to larger and very large terms, and we mapped the interactions from all these different types of networks onto these terms, and we basically just computed the fraction of interactions that are the fraction of edges inside each of the components. So the density of the components. So for each, you know, this would be a perfect density of one, you know, and here it's still pretty high, the density, but you know, you're missing some of the edges, so it's a little lower. And basically what we tried to look at is for any given size of the term, from small terms to larger terms to very large terms, we looked at this average density. And what we see is, of course, you know, something that we probably expected is this density decreases. So, you know, small terms are very, very dense. And then as we go further on, the density, of course, decreases. We do not see a clique of, you know, of thousands of nodes, of course. But the important point is that always for small terms as well as large terms, this density is larger than expected by chance. So if we took networks of the same size and degree distribution and permuted them, we would not get anywhere close to this density of the real networks. And so there's one caveat to this, you know, because this is a hierarchy. The situation we're facing is that small terms are part of larger terms, and so on. And so you might hypothesize that the density of the higher terms is due to some extent just to the density of the lower terms within them. And so we try to correct for that. So basically, we developed a random model that corrects and preserves. You know how these network models are, that they preserve degree distribution all the time. So we basically preserved the degree distribution, but we also preserved this components of any given size. So we had a threshold for component size, and we preserved, you know, very small terms, larger terms, and so on for any given value of the threshold. And then we computed this density for the terms above that size. And what we see is preserving basically the smaller terms, you know, actually preserves some of the density for the larger terms, but not all. And so we looked at the difference between the blue and the gray, and that's the contributed density of any given level of the ontology. So for us, this is evidence that actually there is considerable significant interaction density at any level of this hierarchy. And so this is a support for the hierarchy in the networks themselves. And so this is, you know, preliminary analysis of the network data and trying to argue for hierarchies embedded in networks and hierarchies that are actually consistent in some way with the gene ontology itself. And so having established that, we went ahead and constructed a framework that tries to extract hierarchical structures from data and tries to align them to the gene ontology to see, you know, where they agree, where they're different, and what can we do with that. And so this framework starts off with a, you know, an established method for clustering networks. It's maybe not the most common one, but I think this is actually a very good one. It's a probabilistic model first proposed by Closet et al. In Nature 2008, I believe, and then significant contributions by Park and Bader in 2011. And it's a very nice clustering, probabilistic clustering algorithm that, you know, basically iteratively merges nodes, such as most hierarchical clustering algorithms. But this one in particular looks at the interactions that fall between the nodes that are connected, but also looks at how the edges fall outside. So we want to connect things that have a lot of edges to themselves, but also have similar patterns of interactions to the outside world. And this particular feature of this algorithm, I think, makes it really, really good. But at the end, what we get is still a binary tree, and that's kind of the situation for most hierarchical clustering algorithms. And that's mostly due to, basically computational constraints. The complexity of the algorithm scales exponentially with the number of splits you consider at each node. And so, you know, this, as well as many other algorithms, are construct binary trees. The problem is that this is not always, you know, representative of biology. So we might have a situation where, you know, a process or a complex has many subparts, not just two. And so we would like to be able to capture that in our model. And so you know, this process of constructing a binary tree, it artificially includes binary splits, even though we might want to have a multi-way split. And so the nice thing about this function, again, is that we can actually go back and try to see whether collapsing certain binary splits and making them into multi-way split, we can generalize this probability score and actually have the same type of model that is actually able to say, okay, do I actually want a series of binary splits, or do I just want one multi-way split? And because I'm using this binary tree as a guide that I constructed in the first step, I'm actually not, you know, increasing the complexity of the algorithm, because, you know, I'm using this tree as a guide and just allowing certain merges to be made. So that's one augmentation over the binary clustering algorithm itself. And then, of course, the other problem is that, you know, in biology, many genes and many terms have more than one parent. So certainly genes have more than one function, they participate in more than one process, and even subcomponents themselves, they are often part of multiple processes and functions and so on. And so, you know, we have a tree, and so we have a heuristic procedure in this case that just tries to add additional parents here. And so we can see that it works fairly well in certain cases, but I think it's probably an area where improvement can still be made. But anyway, we do have a post-processing step that tries to identify additional parents to this tree to make it into a DAC structure. And then the final thing is actually, once we have a hierarchy derived from data, we'd like to be able to compare it to the existing gene ontology or any other ontology for that matter. And so this is also a potentially non-trivial operation, And you can do this in many, many ways that are wrong. And so, for instance, you know, we probably all know that, you know, when you do this gene set enrichment analysis against the gene ontology, typically what you get is 100 terms for any given query set of genes, right? So we certainly don't want that situation here. We would like to have a unique mapping between the terms and the ontologies. If we have a greedy unique mapping, then what might happen is that we might align the parent to the child and the child to the parent, and so really this hierarchical structure won't be preserved. And so we need, you know, we developed a procedure that's based on ontology alignment in computer science and other fields that takes into account the hierarchical structure and the gene set similarity. So it's both the similarity of gene sets, such as captured by a hypergeometric test and or a Jacquard score or you know something of that sort, but also preserving the hierarchical structure. So there are certain constraints on the structure that are allowed by this alignment and certain that are not. And so having this pipeline, we can now basically take all these data and construct a hierarchy and annotate it and see where it agrees with the gene ontology or where it doesn't agree. So this is our first iteration of the network extracted ontology, which we call, you know, network extracted ontology. So in short, it's NEXO. And you know, this is kind of the overview of the backbone of just the tree structure without the additional DAG edges. And so, you know, you could start looking at it right here, where the root of the tree falls, and here's the set of all genes from which we split into the mitochondrial part and the membrane and the intracellular region and so on. And you know, in each step we go further into the cell. So it's kind of a hierarchical structure that we can now recognize, you know, subunits of the ribosome and so on. And what's important is that we do have this alignment to the gene ontology. So not only this is just a dendrogram, but really we have labels on the nodes. So we can see, you know, where the best correspondence to the gene ontology is and where the correspondence is very low. And so we can identify potentially new regions of the ontology which don't have mappings to the gene ontology. So really, you know, potentially new components, new hierarchical structures. And we're gonna take a look at some of those later. And so perhaps, you know, the textbook example of a fairly small hierarchical structure that we discovered is the proteasome complex, which itself, just this complex, you know, has two or three levels of hierarchy, really. So the proteasome complex here splits into the core and the regulatory particle. The core splits into the core the beta subunit and the alpha subunit. The regulatory particle splits into the base and the lid subcomplexes. And so, you know, a couple of layers right here, and we think this is, you know, a much more useful representation of the network data than this typical hairball view that's often shown in papers. So this potentially is something that's much more interpretable, and people can actually take a look at it at different scales. And so, you know, overall, what is our correspondence to the gene ontology? So we find that basically a third of our ontology has good mappings to the Go. To different, you know, subcomponents of Go, to biological process, cellular component, and molecular function subontology of the gene ontology. Now, looking the other way, we find that we cover around 60% of the cellular component ontology of the gene ontology, and less about a quarter of biological processes and molecular functions. And certainly an area that, you know, we could potentially look at, are there other data sets or maybe, you know, an augmentation of the procedure that we could potentially improve on in this regard. But this is how it looks today. And so another sort of test of how well or how not well we do against Go is to just use it in the most common way that Go is used today. And this is basically for gene ontology enrichment analysis. And so we took two data sets that were not used to construct NEXO, and we did enrichment analysis against Go and against NEXO. And so basically the two data sets are the Hillemeyer et al. Data set, and that's basically a chemogenomic screen, which they basically knocked out every single gene in yeast under 400 different conditions. And the idea is that we can identify genes that are essential for the yeast to grow under a specific condition. And so if we have that set of genes that are essential in a specific condition, then potentially that's a specific function of those genes that we should be looking at. And so we should be taking those essential genes and doing enrichment against Go or against NEXO and try to see, okay, what are the actual essential components of this cell that are responsible for, you know, keeping the cell alive under certain conditions. That's kind of the idea. So we want to find an enriched term either in Go or in NEXO. And what we show is that, you know, basically we can always find a term that's also enriched. So this is non-trivial. If we, you know, permute the ontology of degraded completely, we would not be finding enriched sets. But here we are actually doing slightly better than Go in terms of covering the whole space of 400 different conditions and identifying a component that's specific to a given condition. Similar analysis, although with different data. Here we're looking at the targets of 200 different transcription factors in yeast, and we're asking if the set of target genes is enriched or not for any given process or component, and so on. And again, doing pretty much covering the same space as the gene ontology. So in terms of covering the biology, if you like, you know, if you believe that these data sets are a proxy for this, pretty much cover the same space. And so another thing, just, you know, apart from just capturing the same things as Go captures, is that we can discover potentially things that are new. And so what happens here is that we're looking at the chromosome remodeling region of the Next ontology. It's a particularly good region, I think, and it captures many chromatin remodeling complexes, but Go also captures some of these complexes. So, you know, for instance, we had this Y-SNF, the RISC complex, the SWER1, and INO80. Those are all very well-known chromatin remodeling complexes, and in Go, they're annotated under the chromosome remodeling complex. In Nexo, we also have a chromatin remodeling complex term, and we have all the same, you know, complexes. Now, what we can see is the different hierarchical structure that arises. So, for instance, Go identifies all these complexes and just puts them under chromatin remodeling complex. We, on the other hand, have another layer of hierarchy here. So we actually identify what's known to be a SWI-SNF family of complexes and what's known to be an INO80 family of complexes. In this particular case, the terms we identify directly from the tree structure here, we can go back to literature and ask, okay, is this something that is known, or is this complete mess, or is it real or not? In this particular case, we're actually able to find papers that talk about these families of complexes. So we contacted the genealogy curators and editors, and they were actually kind enough to put those terms into the genealogy. So we started from data, identified those terms, and augmented Go from this analysis. Here are some types of relationships that we also identify, new relationships that were put into Go based on the same, you know, principle, starting from data, identifying new relationships and putting them into Go. But we can only do this given the rules of Go. We can only do this when we find a paper. So we still have to go through this indirect way of, you know, from data to still finding a paper that talks about something like that to augmenting Go. And so, you know, a lot of times, of course, we find things we don't have a paper for, and potentially these are the most interesting things because nobody has ever looked at them yet. So here in the Golgi traffic machinery, we find a whole sub-hierarchy that we were able to validate using genetic interaction screening. I'm running out of time, am I? Okay. So what can we do with the new terms that are not in the literature, but we still want to say something about them? Well, we can do more experiments, basically, to try to figure out, first of all, whether those terms make sense, and what are they. So in this particular case for the Golgi apparatus, we were able to provide new data, genetic interaction data sets that were, again, not used in the ontology construction, to try to corroborate this hierarchical structure. And all you need to know about the genetic interaction screens in this case is that the better correlated the genetic profiles are of two genes, the more functionally related those genes tend to be. And so what we see is that if we look at pairs of genes that fall within very small specialized components that we identify, this correlation is very high. Okay, so the green sort of distribution here corresponds to the correlation within specialized terms, and we see that it's very high. It's a little lower when we go to larger, more general terms, and it's still, you know, the background model for this Golgi apparatus term as a whole, because that's still a small part of the whole ontology. So we kind of see that the new genetic interaction profiling screen kind of confirmed the hierarchical relationships that are evident here. So from specialized terms to more and more general terms, we decrease this correlation of genetic interaction profiles. And again, this is a new data set, so not used in the construction of the ontology itself. I'll skip this, but briefly mentioned that, you know, we have some examples of specific new terms that we discovered where the correlation of the new screen kind of confirms the relationships between these genes. But Broadly speaking, you know, what can we do with all the, I think, 500 different terms that we discovered that we think are very well supported by the network data? So, of course, sometimes we find things that, you know, maybe don't look as good as we think, so we wouldn't be really interested in analyzing them further. But we found around 500 terms in this Nexo structure that we feel really good about, and they have good data support. And they don't have any annotation, so nothing is really known about them. And so what can we do in terms of, you know, using or leveraging existing data sets, potentially doing new experiments to try to really put functions on those new terms? And so one thing we can do is we can, again, go back to this Hillenmeier data set. And now when we identify, you know, a component such as this one, this is a set of six genes. And it's a component that basically falls under the mitochondrial subtree of the ontology. So if you think about this large picture, it would be somewhere up here. So this is a new term. All these genes are basically unknown function, okay? Nothing is really known, not much really is known about them. And really nothing is known about their relationships together as a term, and nothing is really known about them being placed under the mitochondria. So it's all new stuff potentially. So it's either, you know, it's either bogus or it's true, and it's interesting then. And so what we did is we looked at this Hillenmeier data set. In this particular case, all these six genes are essential for yeast to grow under the mercury chloride treatment, okay? And mercury chloride induces oxidative stress, okay? And oxidative stress in turn induces apoptosis through a mitochondria-related pathway. So there's some functional link here, maybe not very strong, but there is, okay? Another thing that's known about some of these genes is that some of them are vaguely related to maintenance of telomere capping, okay? And so interestingly, if you look at the literature, not these genes, but some other telomere maintenance genes, including telomerase, are actually known to localize to the mitochondria under oxidative stress. And so now we're trying to, you know, basically develop this story, and of course it's incomplete and needs new experiments, but at least you can have some kind of a functional hypothesis about these terms coming from these chemogenomic experiments. And this is really what we're trying to do, provide a starting point for people, for experts in this particular area of biology to try to look at this and see if they're interested in and follow up and confirm or you know, disprove the component that we find. And so we did this for over 100 components. We were able to identify these chemogenomic enrichment under a particular chemogenomic condition. So for instance, some of them are, you know, potential modules that are responsible for repairing DNA, for instance. So they might be, you know, very relevant to cancer biology and so on. And so these are all, you know, hypotheses coming out of this structure and large-scale data on top of that. I'm almost done. So really what we would like to have is all these white dots here that are not known today to map to the gene ontology to fill out this map and really put labels on this and try to see, you know, what are they. So just as the genes were not known, we think, you know, some of these components are really true components that we need to discover functions for. And so we're now developing, this is live, although it might still have some problems. So don't want to advertise it too heavily, but it will very soon be live in a good version. So nexoontology.org, and you can actually browse this structure and also the gene ontology itself. Like to thank people who contributed to this work. First of all, Triadiker, my postdoc mentor, Michael Kramer, who I worked most closely on this project. Mike Cherry and Rama Barakrishnan helped us a lot with understanding the Go and the relationships and actually trying to augment Go from data. And Nevin Krogan and Michal Surma responsible for the genetic interaction profiling. Thank you for our, you know, the travel fellowship, and thanks to the funding sources, and thanks very much for listening. And I'll take any questions if you have. Well, you know, it's another data set, so it's a data set that hasn't been used to construct the ontology. So it would be circular if I were to take the same data set and use it twice. But I think, you know, it's kind of like, I think it's pretty consistent with every other situation. If you want to confirm or disprove something, you do another experiment. And as long as you know it's not exactly the same type, and we can look, of course, we can look in detail. So are we actually taking the same links, right? And we have, you know, in the supplement of the paper, we have all these corrections, right? So what if you take, you know, set of links that is non-overlapping with the set of links that we use for construction and so on? So, you know, we have some of these tests, of course, but in general, it's a new experiment. So, you know, it's not, I don't think it's circular in that way.